Hello, good people. Today we are going to be discussing on how to design a column to the British standard BS-10. I'm going to be doing it in two parts. The first part is we're going to classify and the second part we're going to classify the column. I actually chose to start with the design of the column since it's much easier to understand. Okay, what happens is, if you have a column and it is fixed at the top and fixed at the bottom, you have you multiply the length by 0.7 to get the effective length. This is due to the fact that as it approaches the fixed end, it does not deflect because of its fixity. It's in a asymptote like situation that happens there. Okay, when it is pinned at the top there, there's a freedom of rotation at the top, but there's no freedom of rotation at the bottom. It is you multiply it by a factor of 0.85. Okay, when it is pinned, this is common for trusses. Trusses are pinned, it is multiplied by a factor of 1. Now, when it is fixed at the top and fixed at the bottom, and there is an ability to sway, you multiply it by a factor of 1 to 1.2. When it is free to rotate at the top and they are fixed at the bottom, you multiply by a factor of 1.5. When it is fixed and free at the top, you multiply to get the effective length, you multiply it by 2, meaning that the weakest is the one that is free at the top. There's a table here. You should take a look at this table. Okay, so if we have a column, and when we have a column, the first thing is we calculate the effective length. The effective length is based on the idea that is it fixed at the top and fixed at the bottom or something like that. Then we divide that length by the radius of gyration in the y plane. We get what is called the lambda or the slenderness. So now when we have the slenderness, we now use that slenderness to we come to this curve here. These are called strut curves. So the value that we get and the strength that we have of steel here, if we have a slenderness of 122, then the strength, the grade of steel is S275, then the strength that column can carry per square millimeter is this number. So we multiply this one by the cross-sectional area, then we get the carrying capacity of that particular column. Okay, that is the first part. The second part now, this is the golden formula that we are using. The effective length is here, the radius of gyration is here. Now, when we are dealing with a column, we have to classify this section first. As you can see here, we have what we call the T. This is the thickness of the, this part is called the flange. This is called the web. The thickness of the flange and the thickness of the web are important. Then this is the breadth of the flange. This is the breadth of the web. These are very important. Okay, let me explain how important these are. Okay, what happens is we classify steel based on this particular thing so that we can classify it as either slender. When it is slender, this is these are moments here. This is the principal moment. This is the moment that it can carry. It gets to that point and it can stretch before it ruptures. But now when it's semi-compact, it just gets to that, to this point, and it breaks. The slender one will break before it gets to this particular strength. Okay, so what we do is the B. This is another table that you should take a look at, okay? For us to come up with what is called, as you can see, this is 9 epsilon. Epsilon is actually 275 divided by Py. Py being the strength of the steel that we are dealing with. Okay, we take a square root of that. Okay, we multiply that by 9. This number should always be greater than B, which is the half of the flange divided by the thickness of the flange. Okay, if it's Under 9 epsilon, it is considered to be plastic, which is what we normally want to deal with. Okay, when it's less than 10 epsilon, it is compact. Okay, these two, we deal with these in columns. Now, so as you can see here, when we're talking about the flange, we're talking about this one, the big T. When we're talking about the web, we're talking about the small T. As you can see, when it comes to the web now, the D is the distance between the depth of the web, we divide it by the thickness of the web. If it's less than 80 epsilon, it is okay, or 100 epsilon. Okay, the other two, the other classes don't apply. Okay, when we were talking about the slenderness of the flange, we were dividing this B here, this is from this point to that point, with the thickness, which is the big T here. It's supposed to be less than 9 epsilon for it to be classified as plastic. And when we're talking about the web, we were dividing from this to here, which is the D, this one, and we divide it by T. If it's less than 80 epsilon, it is considered to be plastic. This is very important, since we usually recommend that you use a plastic section. Okay, now I think we are done with this first part.